Dear friends, today's topic for discussion is Civil Procedure Code or the Code of Civil Procedure 1908, Part 1. In this lecture, I wish to take up introduction, historical background and scheme of the Civil Procedure Code. This subject, Civil Procedure Code, is one of the most important branches of law. It is not only very important in LLB, but also very important in advocacy. As a member of bench and bar, you must have sound knowledge in Civil Procedure Code. This subject is not only very important for LLB studies, but also it is very important for judicial officer exams and other examinations. I sincerely suggest my student friends to concentrate very well on CPC, CRPC evidence. Here, after this subject, I will take up Limitation Act. In some universities, CPC is independent subject. In some universities, Limitation Act is added to CPC. Previously, long back when we were studying, Limitation Act and Arbitration Act were added to the Code of Civil Procedure. All the Code of Civil Procedure, the Limitation Act and Arbitration Act, all are procedural laws. So, the procedural law is that branch of law that provides procedure to be followed in a court of law while filing a case, if it is civil court, for filing, instituting a suit in civil court, or filing a petition in civil court, or filing an application in civil court, or if it is a criminal court, the criminal procedure code lays down procedure for filing, how to lodge complaint with police officer, how to give first information report to police officer, how to lodge complaint with magistrate, all this procedure. So the procedure to be followed in civil courts is studied in Civil Procedure Code, and the procedure to be followed in criminal court is studied in Criminal Procedure Code. So in previous lectures I explained you, law can be classified under various heads: private law, public law, general law, special law, substantive law, procedural law, like this. For the purpose of this subject, we can say that law is broadly categorized under two heads. One is substantive law, the other is procedural law. Substantive law defines what facts constitute a right or liability. In other words, it contains the principles of particular branch of law. Procedural law is one by which substantive law is applied to a particular cases. Simply speaking, substantive law defines various principles relating to particular branch of law. Procedural law provides procedure for implementation of substantive principles. What is substantive law? What is procedural law? Substantive law simply contains the principles. Procedural law provides mechanism for implementation or enforcement of the principles under substantive law. Substantive law is superior to procedural law. Procedural law is subordinate to substantive law. Means the procedure laid down in procedural law or adjective law must be in strict consonance or in strict adherence to the principles of substantive law. This is the position. That is why we say that law may be broadly categorized under two heads, namely substantive law and other is procedural law. Substantive law determines various principles relating to rights and liabilities of parties in a suit or dispute. Parties in a suit or dispute. Whereas the procedural law or adjectival law. Procedural law is also known as adjective law or adjectival law. It provides way procedure and mechanism for improving enforcement and or implementation of the principles laid out at the substantive law. So the procedure must be according to the principles of substantive law. That is why substantive law is superior to procedural law. This is clear. Now, some branches of law are purely substantive laws. Some branches of law are purely procedural laws, whereas some branches of law are both substantive and procedural, contain procedural except. Substantive law contains various principles. For example, Indian Penal Code, Indian Contract Act, Indian Evidence Act, Transfer of Property Act, these are various branches of law, they are substantive laws. Procedural laws means Indian Evidence Act, Civil Procedure Code, Criminal Procedure Code, Limitation Act, Arbitration Act, these are the branches of procedural law. But you have to take that in case of criminal law, there is one branch exclusively deals with substantive principles. For example, Indian Penal Code 1860 contains principles and offenses, principles and specific offenses. The substantive criminal law is Indian Penal Code 1860. But the procedural law of crimes is Criminal Procedure Code. So in examination question paper, the law of the criminal law is given, but criminal law is two categories. One is substantive law of crimes, that is Indian Penal Code 1860. The other branch is procedural law of crimes, the Code of Criminal Procedure 1973. Why? Because substantive law, that is Indian Penal Code, defines various offenses and prescribes punishment for respective offenses. Procedural law of crimes, that is Criminal Procedure Code, provides mechanism for implementation of criminal law. For example, in a court hall, the accused who is alleged to have committed some murder is tried in a district sessions court. When a witness is giving witness evidence against him, he picks up revolver from nearby police officer and fires a bullet in the presence of lawyers, judges and other members of the public. It is a murder punishable under, it is a murder according to section 300 IPC. It is punishable up to life imprisonment or death sentence under section 302. But it is a clear case of murder. But the session judge, though he is competent to decide the case, he will not give judgment on the spot. He cannot pronounce life imprisonment or death sentence as the case may be. There is a lot of procedure. Some information should be given in police station as the first information report, or complaint can be lodged directly in magistrate. Then the police will start investigation. In investigation also, the bail procedure is to be followed. Then it will be police report is to be submitted, and that police report is given to police report is submitted in to court, and the case is commuted, numbering, chief examination, cross examinations, lot of procedure is followed in. So that is why what we can understand is certain branches of law simply lays down principles of the respective law, but branches of law lay down procedural aspects. So that is why the law is broadly categorized into two heads. One is substantive law and other is procedural law. Indian Contract Act, Indian Evidence Act, Transfer of Properties Act, Dowry Provision Act, these are all substantive laws. Procedural laws, Indian Evidence Act is procedural law, and criminal procedure code is procedural law, but civil procedure code is, broadly speaking, it is a branch of procedural law, but it contains two bodies. One body, first part one, containing body, the part, first part of the code is body. It contains 158 sections. They lay down various principles of administration of civil justice. But part two, which contains schedule, it covers 151 orders and various rules connected to. The number of rules vary from order to order, followed by appendices, formats, prescribed forms of 8, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So, like this. So, that is why in the civil procedure code, broadly it is in one way, mainly we say that the code of civil procedure is a procedural law, but the first part of the code containing, that is the code, body containing 158 sections, lays down various principles. But where the second part, the schedule, contains 51 orders, which contain several rules, and followed by 8 formats, that is procedural aspect. So, this is 2-in-1. CPC is one way, substantive law, in other way, procedural aspect, but however, we call it as procedural law. In some topics in CPC, exclusively studied under section, some topics are exclusively studied under orders and rules, whereas some topics are studied under sections as well as orders. This is the significance of civil procedure code. So the student is expected to know about this difference. So here, now let us now discuss about the subject, the historical background of the subject. Civil Procedure Code 1908. First time, don't think that Civil Procedure Code was passed in the year 1908 only. Previously, there were legislations on Civil Procedure Code. Now we have to discuss about the historical background about this Civil Procedure Code. Here, right from the beginning, when we think about administration of justice, the administration of justice is broadly divided into two parts. One is administration of civil justice, other is administration of criminal justice. So, for administration of civil justice, some procedure is to be followed. For administration of criminal justice, this distinct pattern of procedure is to be followed. So, the procedure for administration of civil justice was not there till 1859. So, the civil procedure, the law relating to a procedure in administration of civil courts was not available till 1859. Before that, the charter acts were followed. Before acts, the crown charters, the procedure was followed according to, there were Sadar Diwani Adalat, Sadar Nizam Adalat, Crown's Courts, Supreme Courts, all were there. Now, for the first time, but our India, you know, dear friends, our India was in British rule for a period of 3.5 centuries, 1600 AD to 1950, when our Indian constitution came into force. So, during British period, the credit for codification of procedure in civil court goes in favor of Sir Charles Wood. He was the president. President of the board for affairs in India. So, this gentleman, there was a board constituted in British Empire to look after the affairs of the affairs in India. For that board, the chairman was, the president was Sir Charles Wood. This Sir Charles Wood instructed, took initiative and instructed the Second Law Commission to prepare a bill on for codification of civil procedure, procedure in civil courts, and he gave instruction accordingly. Dear friends, I told you so many times, the codification was started with the appointment of First Law Commission. First Law Commission, Second Law Commission could not finalize any codification process. The process was in initial stage during First Law Commission and Second Law Commission, and Third Law Commission, 17 branches of law were codified. Among them, Indian Penal Code was there, Contract Act was there, Indian Contract Act 1872 there was there, Indian Evidence Act 1872 were there, Special Marriage Act was there, and so many acts were there. So 19 acts were passed. As and when law was to be codified, law commissions were to be constituted. Accordingly, 17 law commissions were constituted. So in India, most of the legislations were passed since 1860. First legislation 1860 was Indian Penal Code, and so many branches of our law, the legislations are more than 150 years. 1860 means 40 years, 140 years plus 20 years, 160 years. So, our Indian legislations are, there are so many legislations which are more than 100 years. In the recent past, time to time, legislations are passed, and these legislations were passed keeping in mind the requirement and socio-economic conditions at that time. However, most of the provisions of the old legislations are being repeated. For example, Indian Companies Act. Companies Act was the law relating to companies was regulated by Companies Act 1956. So the Companies Act was old Companies Act was passed in 1956, and after so many more than 25 amendment acts, the Indian Companies Act is revised in the year 2013. But even though it is 13. In old act 658 sections, new act 470 sections, so changes are there, and most of the sections in old act are repeated, but section number is changed, but the content in sections are one and the same. So like that, there are so many legislations in India which are more than 100-150 years from that time laws are codified, and even today laws are being codified. Originally, the central legislature, the parliament comprising of Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, headed by President of India, is competent to pass legislation. But even though Indian central legislature won't be able to pass each and every law, then the power of passing legislation is given to states, state legislature. That is what is called under delegation of authority. Under delegated legislation power, state governments are passing laws. And similarly, state legislatures are delegating the power to independent bodies, local authorities, municipal corporations, municipalities, and companies and other boards. So like this, and laws are basically some laws are passed by central legislature, that is parliament. Some laws are passed by the state legislature. Some laws are passed by the subordinate bodies. Anyway, the state laws passed by the state legislature are applicable to states, but the laws passed by central legislature are applicable to whole country. But even then, even though a law passed by central legislature basically contain the provisions relating to center as a whole, but there will be some specific provision, some areas are applicable to some states, some areas are not applicable to some areas, and an option is given to certain states to make necessary changes so as to suitable to their socio-economic condition. So like this, the code of civil procedure, contains two parts. Part 1 is the body of the code. It contains 158 sections. All the sections relate to central legislature. If any section is to be deleted or new section is to be added, if any amendment act is to be passed affecting the affecting any provision or provisions of this code, first part 158 section, that act must be done by parliament, that is central legislature only. Whereas part 2 schedule, this is only one schedule. At the time of codification of civil procedure, there were 158, at the time of codification, there were 5 schedules. In subsequent amendments, 4 schedules were deleted. And today, the Code of Civil Procedure comprises of 2 parts. First part containing the body, it has 158 section. Second part is the schedule. It contains 51 orders. Every order contains some rules. Some orders contain more rules. Some orders contain less rules. Then at the end of the rules, there is eight appendices means they are the formats, pro formas of plaint pleadings, that is plaint, written statement, decree, reference, revision, and different procedure. In independent topics, I will take up all these things. So, like this, what is the historical background of the CPC? So, before 1859, there was no code of civil procedure applicable in civil courts. First time in the year, Sir Charles Wood, who was the president for the, who was the president of the board for Indian affairs, he instructed the second law commission to formulate law, formulate the simple principles of law applied in civil courts of India. But accordingly, the third law commission passed the code of civil procedure, that is act number 8 of 1859, in the year 1859. At that time, there were 2 types of courts. The British Empire was broadly categorized under 2 heads. One is president is Madras, Bombay, Calcutta, and provinces and rural provinces, Bengal, Bihar, Orissa provinces. And in president is Madras, Bombay, Calcutta, supreme courts for, that is crown's courts were functioning. At Bengal, Bihar, Orissa, provincial courts were functioning. That is, the provincial courts were functioning according to judicial plan formulated by the concerned governor general, that is Warren Hastings, Cornwallis, Bentinck, and so on. But these crown courts were functioning, mayor courts, supreme, up to supreme court, they were functioning according to crown charter passed by the British crown. So the British supreme court at Bombay, Madras, Bombay, Calcutta were crown court. The Sadar Adalat, Sadar Diwani Adalat, Sadar Nizamat, the Sadar Diwani Adalat, Sadar Nizamat Adalat. Sadar Diwan Adalat means highest court of judicature dealing with civil cases. Sadar Nizamat Adalat was the highest court of judicature dealing with the criminal matters. But supreme courts were dealing with both the civil and the criminal matters. But in the year 1861, Indian High Court Act was passed. With the passing of the Indian High Courts Act, High Courts, the Sadar Adalats and Supreme Court, Crown Courts and Provincial Courts, both were merged. But when this Code of Civil Procedure 1859 was passed, the provisions were applied only in Sadar Adalats, but they were not applicable in Supreme Courts. And thereafter, as it was not followed after the after passing of High Courts Act, Sadar Adalats and Supreme Courts both were merged. For the convenience of application of the principles of civil procedure in both the in high courts. That is, previously, before Indian High Courts Act, Crown courts were there in presidencies, provincial courts were there in mofussils, and when these two courts were merged, Crown courts and Sadar Adalats were merged, only three high courts were there. One at Madras, one at Bombay, one at Calcutta. Only three high courts. They were having all civil, criminal, all jurisdiction was there. But in order to apply the principles of civil procedure, this old act, 1859 act, was abolished, repealed. In its place, a new act was passed. That is the Code of Civil Procedure 1877. This Code of 1800, the Civil Procedure Code 1877, witnessed so many amendments. So many amendments were made in 1877 Act. After that, that Act also was abolished, and another Act was replaced. That is Civil Procedure Code 1882. This also faced some problems. And ultimately, this 1882 Act also was abolished. In its place, the Code of Civil Procedure was passed in the year 1908. So, before the passing of the Civil Procedure Code 1908, there were three legislations. One, the Code of Civil Procedure 1859, the Code of Civil Procedure 1877, and the Code of Civil Procedure 1882. And repealing the preceding act, the Civil Procedure Code 1908 was passed. So, as I told you, this Code of Civil Procedure lays down various principles and procedural aspects relating to civil courts, administration of civil justice in India. As I told, this Civil Procedure Code contains two parts, namely body of the court secondly the schedule. First part, CPC, Civil Procedure Code 1910, comprises of two parts. Part 1, body of the court, it contains 158 sections divided into 12 parts. All the 12 parts containing 158 sections lay down substantive principles. This area can be touched only by the central legislature. If any amendment has to be made, if the authorities want to bring about any change in this first part of the code, that is body, 158 sections, any provision can be changed only by the Amendment Act of the Central Legislature only. So, this body contains 158 sections divided into 12 parts. Now, we come to second part. Second part of the code is the schedule. This schedule contains 51 orders. Every order contains rules. Rule 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like this. Some orders contain more rules. Some orders contain less number of rules. At the end of the rules, there is eight appendices. This, what is the model of plaint? What is the model, prescribed model of written statement? What is the prescribed model of decree? What is the prescribed model of order? What is the prescribed model for reference review? What are the prescribed models for summons? All these things are there. There are eight models, and all these aspects I will explain in detail, dear friends. So now, I repeat once again, the body 158 sections, any area is to be amended, it can be done by Amendment Act passed by the Parliament only. If any area is to be changed under 51 rules and appendices, the necessary action can be taken by the high courts of the particular state. So, the central government gives some guidelines, keeping in mind the requirement of all the states as a whole. But the socio-economic conditions and requirements of certain states may be different. So, that is why the concerned state high courts can make necessary changes. So, the highest authority in state level in administration of justice, high court of the respective state. So, that is why the high court of a concerned state can make any changes in any order, in any rule, and pro formats. So this is this High Court's under Article 122 to 127 and 129 to 131. And all these actions, Article 122 to 127 and Article 129 to 131, all the Supreme Courts, the High Courts of the respective states are empowered to take this power, empowered to make any changes in second schedule, second part, that is second part, that is 51 orders containing various rules. So this is about this thing. So this Code of Civil Procedure K was passed in the year 19. Now I want to take I want to explain in brief about the code of the civil procedure code in detail. So what are the I have to give the sketch of the code and the code at a glance, the civil procedure code at a glance. Here I told you civil procedure code first part contains 158 sections divided into 12 parts. Second part contains schedule containing 51 orders. Each order contains so many rules, and thereafter rules appendices, 8 appendices are there. So now see what are this is part 1 starts after it's part 1 of the code starts from section 9 only. Now we have to discuss about section 1 to 9. Section 1 to 9 preliminary aspects. Section 1 to 8 of the code deal with preliminary aspects, the title of the subject. What is section 1 tells that? What is the title of the subject? The Code of the Civil Procedure 1908. That is the title. It is a territorial law. Territorial law means it is a central legislation, it applies to whole of India except the state of Jammu and Kashmir at that time, and also the state of Nagaland and certain parts, certain tribal areas. Whenever any act is passed by the parliament, that is central legislature, they may pass it with a certain condition. Which areas it is to be applied, which areas it is to be applied, what sections or what area is to be implemented immediately, what area is to be implemented later. So many conditional, some acts directly this act applies to whole of India except the state of Jammu and Kashmir only thing. Some acts this is not applicable to that area this thing. So some parts remain unnotified, and 75% is notified, 25% is not notified. So if you go through the various enactments at the so far as the their notification is concerned, you will be able to know about. Sir. For example, when Indian Companies Act 2013 was passed in the year 2013, so many chapters were not notified. When so such chapters are notified, the old rules will follow. In company law lecture 5, I explained all these things in detail. Now, first section 1 deals with section 1 deals with section 1 deals with title. The code is called the Code of Civil Procedure 1908 and 90 sorry the title of the subject, name of the subject is the Code of Civil Procedure 1908. Now it applies to whole of India except the state of Jammu and Kashmir and some areas of Nagaland. However, in the recent act of central government abolishing Article 370 of the Indian Constitution. Article 370 of the Indian Constitution confers a conferred independent status from the beginning, since the emergency passing of our Indian Constitution. The state of Jammu and Kashmir was given independent autonomy, but because of this independent autonomy, there is the incidence of problems and conflicts are innumerable. There is a permanent consistent headache to the government. So that is why the Union government, the re-elected BJP government headed by Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi in association with the Home Minister, they took initiative to abolish, to discard Article 370 of Indian Constitution. By that, the independent autonomy conferred on Jammu and Kashmir vanished, disappeared. So now, the Jammu and Kashmir also is like any one of the states in India, states or union territories in India. Now, any act with that act of abolition or of Article 370, all legislations are extended to Jammu and Kashmir. Earlier, before the abolition of this Article 370, if any particular branch of law was to be extended to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, the parliament had to pass a separate act called Extension of Jurisdiction to Jammu and Kashmir Act. So there were so many welfare legislations like workmen's compensation and others. So when the provisions of any acts were to be extended to the Jammu and Kashmir, separately one separate act was passed by the parliament. That act is called Extension of Jurisdiction to Jammu and Kashmir Act. So if the with the recent decision abolishing Article 370, such a separate act to extend the jurisdiction to Jammu and Kashmir is not necessary, but Jammu and Kashmir have become part and parcel of India, there are no any restriction. So that is with reference to this here. Now code 1 to section 1. Section 2 of the 1 to 8 deal with preliminary concepts. So section 1 is over. Section 2, most of the legislations section 2 or section 3 contain section 2 or section 3 contain section 2 or section 3 contain various definitions. In some for evil of evidence, section 3 provides various definitions. Some legislation, so section 2 contain so many definitions. Before that, I wanted to forget one thing. The code of civil procedure was amended several times. The code was the civil procedure code was amended naturally in view of socio-economic conditions. As the time passed, we are in a global village. We are in people are now, what were necessities, what were luxuries long back became luxuries today. So the socio-economic changes are being taken up. In my boyhood time, only rich people children or really talented people could go to America. But today, in every house, one child is there when is now in abroad. So going to socio-economic changes, laws are to be amended. So like that, the civil procedure code was amended from 1909 to 956. The civil procedure code was passed in the year 1908. It came into force from 1st January 1908. And between 1908 and 1956, it was amended for 30 times. Secondly, in 2002 Amendment Act, so many amendments were made to CPC. And subsequently, 2015, 16, 17, 18, several amendment acts were passed, bringing about so many changes. But in Commercial Courts Act 2015 was passed. This Commercial Courts Act 2015 brought about some changes in civil procedure. And subsequently, when an amendment act was proposed to bring about drastic changes, some agitation was made by lawyers all over India. And if you refer Google, the details you can find out in the details and agitation, and that amendment was stopped. Now coming to the preliminary aspects, section 1 deal with extent to applicability, etc. And second, section 2 defines so many definitions. We discuss about some important definition. I give you a little idea, and I will discuss all the topics in detail from second lecture. Number one is decree. Decree means when one person files a case in civil court, he will file a plaint. How a complaint is lodged in criminal court, plaint is, suppose I gave 1 lakh loan to somebody, he did not repay. I will file deeply with the promissory note, I will file a case against him. So I will make so many, I will make allegation that he took 1 lakh loan and he did not give anything, he executed a promissory note. This 1 lakh amount with other costs of the suits may be demanded. So when I want to lodge a suit, file a suit, institute a suit in civil court, a plaint is to be drafted. Plaint is a pleading. One of the pleadings is plaint. When plaint is, that is what is called, when plaint is filed, when plaint is filed, immediately the court will entertain it, give number it, and it will issue summons. Summons, what are summons? I have explained in detail in criminal procedure code. Then so-and-so allegations are made, you are required to give your reply. So the reply given by defendant is called, that is also a pleading, that is called written statement. Plain to written statement I will explain in detail. Generally, prince plaintiff says that he has to give money. Defendant says that he need not give any money, like that. That is reply. The case filed by plaintiff, that is, in order to file a case in civil court, plaintiff files plaint. When plaint is filed, the court will give, will order the other party, he is called defendant. Then defendant is required to appear before the court with the written explanation. That written explanation is called written statement. And the information, the direction given to that man, is called summon. And after that, the proceedings will be started. Suppose if the judgment is to be given in favor of the plaintiff, it is called decree. Sometimes, in some cases, decree is awarded by the court. In some cases, order is awarded by the court. Section 2, Clause 2 defines decree. Section 2, Clause 14 defines order. Defines order means, decree means plaintiff has won the case. Order means plaintiff has won the case. So, here, when a plaint is filed, the outcome is decree. Suppose sometimes plaintiff files plaint, sometimes plaintiff files petition, sometimes plaintiff files application, or any praying the court something. The plaintiff may file an application to set off. He may file an application for counterclaim and all. What is set off? What is counterclaim? I will tell. So there may be. So that is called in some special acts, Land Acquisition Act and other acts, the court may give order. So, when plaint is filed, order is, decree is awarded by the court. When sometimes, whether a plaint is filed, petition is filed, application is filed seeking something, and suppose plaintiff files a case against defendant, he has to pay 1 lakh. But when he is about to win the case, plaintiff can also file an application. Sir, if decree is given, that man may not, he will avoid the decree. He may leave the state, he may leave the place, he may go out of the country, and please see that his property is attached, or he may be arrested before judgment. He may put an application. For that, the court may appoint some commission and inquire into that. If the commission report is okay, then the court will arrest him before give order for arrest of that man, that defendant, or the court may order for attachment of the property. So in such cases, the word order is used for this. So decree and order, what is decree, what is order, what are the various steps, concepts involved in it, I will tell you. Next definition is means profit, section 2, clause 12. Section 2, Clause 12. So, what it means profits? Suppose A has immovable property, B unlawfully occupied the B's property and doing some cultivation. So, when B is cultivating A's land unlawfully, that is dispossession of A's land by B, and when he is enjoying income, when he is enjoying a crop from that land, that value is called means profit. So when A files a case against B, the court will order for return of the means profits. Suppose B dispossessed A's land, and there he has made some developments. He has erected some motor, he has erected some facilities for better agriculture. So that what are the extra facilities done, that need not be returned, but what is the actual enjoyment of the benefit, that must be returned. That is what is called means profits. This means profit topic I will return. I will explain in detail in respective topic. Next one is legal representative. Section 2, Clause 2 of the Clause 11. Section 2, Clause 11 of the civil procedure code defines legal representative. Legal representative means when a person died before death, he writes a will, then his property will have to be distributed as per the contents of the will. In the contents of the will, he will mention the name. After my death, my property should be handed over to somebody. That is, that man, this property is to be distributed, and this property will be handed out to some person. That person is called executor. And the property will be distributed according to the contents of the will. So after the death, the property will be handed out to some responsible person whose name is mentioned in the will. That man is called executor. Suppose he did not mention any name, the court will appoint, when the dispute appears before the court will appoint some responsible person. The court will appoint a person, he is called administrator. That administrator or executor is called legal representative under section 211 of the Civil Procedure Code. This legal representative, who is an executor or administrator, an executor means named by deceased person, administrator means he is appointed by the court for disposal of the property, and the same is to be distributed among the his legal heirs. That is what is called a legal representative. This topic, the legal representative is a person who takes cognizance of the estate of the deceased person, a person who died, and he is called legal representative. Next, this is section 2 is over. Section 3 to 8, these sections deal with constitution and jurisdiction of civil courts. Civil courts are to be constituted, what are the jurisdiction. Today, earlier district munsif and subordinate judge, district judge, like that was there. Now recently, the designations of the judges differ from state to state. And as a overall, the first, when a person is to be appointed as judge first time, he is called junior judge, junior civil judge, junior division. After promotion, senior civil judge, senior division. Chief judge, that is district judge. So like that. So taluk level judge is taluk level judge. He may be junior civil judge, junior civil judge, senior, and chief judge, that is district judge. So when these judges deal with civil matters, they are called civil judges. When they deal with criminal matter, they are called magistrate. Lower level, they are called magistrate. Higher level, from assistant session judge, when district judge, when he deals with criminal cases, he is called district session judge. When he deals with civil cases, he is called district judge. When some districts, there are two or more districts due to more workload, one will be the principal judge. Principal judge means he will take up the overall administration of the court, that is leaves, promotions, transfers, and all these things. He will do it. That is, he is called principal judge. And workload is there. ADJ 1, ADJ 2, ADJ 3 may be there. One additional judge, two additional judge, three additional judges will be there. Whether district judge and additional judge, deciding a case is concerned, the competence and jurisdiction of the court is concerned, all same. But the principal judge will have overall administrative head. So this is the constitution, powers and jurisdiction of the criminal court, and pecuniary value. Junior civil judge can deal with cases up to 3 lakhs. Senior division deals case with up to 10 lakhs. So district judge will deal with pecuniary matters above 1 lakh. Subject matter in which jurisdiction. All this jurisdiction I will explain in detail. Constitution, powers and jurisdiction of the civil courts. And I explained in detail in constitution, powers and jurisdiction of the criminal courts. You please refer to CRPC also. You can have more knowledge, and I will take up this topic after the code is over. Next, part 1. So, section body of the code contains 158 sections. Body of the code contains 158 sections. Section 158 sections. 158 sections, and it divided into 12 parts. Section 1 to 8, preliminary concepts. Section 9 to 35B, part 1. Part 1 contains sections 9 to 35B. Under this, section 9 speaks about jurisdiction of the civil courts. Civil court. In this case, what is the local jurisdiction? What is the jurisdiction of senior civil judge? What is the jurisdiction of the senior civil judge? What is the jurisdiction of the chief judge? What is the jurisdiction of High Court? What is the jurisdiction of Supreme Court? All these aspects of jurisdiction of civil courts under Section 9 we will discuss. What is the pecuniary matter? What is the matters relating to pecuniary matters? Value of the suit, subject matter of the suit, place of residence, and all these aspects we have to discuss. Section 10 deals with sub judice, stay of suits. Sub judice. Section 10, no, Section 11, they are very important. Section 10 no, deals with sub judice. Section 11 deals with res judicata. These two topics I will discuss in detail. Section 10 means, suppose throw four stones, at least one stone will hit, like that. So that is not case. Suppose A wants to file a case against B, against promissory note for recovery of 1 lakh, he may have, basing on the local area, basing on the property located or on different grounds, there may are some circumstances, the same can be filed in three or more courts are competent to try that case. Suppose if the plaintiff, when plaintiff wants to file a case against defendant, he should file the case in only one court, that is local lowest court of jurisdiction. But when until and unless the decision comes from that court, he should not do anything. Suppose intermittently he files a case in town A, and he also files a case in town B, he also files a case in some town C, if three courts are competent. But when a case is filed between the same parties, same subject matter, same cause of action, when once a case is filed in court A and subsequently he files case in court B or court C, but the subsequent courts do not have any competence to entertain the suit. When they came to know that the suit has already been filed under similar facts and circumstances in previous court, the subsequent court has to stop all further proceeding and dismiss the suit and will order the director. So that is when a case is already pending in a competent court, another court will not encroach upon it, will not try it. So the court will advise the plaintiff, well, you have already filed a case in that court and why you are coming? No, you have to follow accordingly, the court will say. That is one thing. So the bar of filing subsequent suit, that is the court will stay all further proceeding, that is section 10. Section 11 means res judicata. Suppose A can file a case in court A and court B, town A court and town B court. In town A, the suit is dismissed. That means judgment or decree got in favor of, given in favor of defendant. So in this court we lost the case, and why don't we file the case in, if we file this case in the court B town court, we may win the case, not that. So the same court of competence, suppose if a case is filed in court of senior divisional court, then he lost the case. If he wants, he should go prefer appeal before higher court, but he should not file a case fresh in same court. When once a matter has already been decided by the same court of competent jurisdiction, after the decision, the case cannot be filed in another court. That is section 10, section 11. So this is this. So next, similar other grounds for bar of suit. There are other grounds. The final, when a case is already there, another case cannot be filed. 12 is 9, 10, 11, 12 are over. Next, 13. Section 13 deals with foreign court. What is foreign court? A foreign court means a court situated in a foreign country, not in India. if a court is situated in India, as per the by the government of India, that is the Indian court. If it is not situated in India, it is situated under authority of the foreign government, that court is called foreign court. US court, Bangladesh court, or Pakistan court, they are all foreign courts. They are all foreign courts. Then the judgment given by the foreign court is called foreign judgment. So foreign court, foreign judgments, state of nationality, state of domicile, all these aspects you will have to study in private international law, maybe in second year or third year. Some Indian went to America, there he got married to London girl, UK girl. After this, both working for some time in US, they went to Switzerland, they go to Switzerland. There also they come here, they continue their matrimonial home for some time. Thereafter they gave birth to one or two children, and thereafter they got divorced. And so Indian went to America, he got married to English girl, and thereafter they went to Switzerland. There also they stayed for some time. Thereafter they went to West Germany. There they got separated. During the matrimonial time, they gave birth to two children. In that case, they have some properties, movable properties or immovable properties, to validity of marriage, legitimacy of children, and properties. All the problems will come. And when that these issues are to be there, the principles of private international law are to be applied. While doing that, the state of nationality is applied, the state of domicile is applied, and all the cases are to apply, whether the court is competent or not, all these aspects will come. You will have to study this topic in private international law or conflict of laws. The law in India differs from law in America. The law in America differs from UK. For example, adultery is an offense in India. It is no offense in America. It is civil wrong in UK. So like this. So these are the various issues, foreign court, foreign judgment, we have to discuss. Next, 15 to 21A deal with place of suing. Where the case is to be filed, where the case is to be filed. Sometimes whether the dispute takes place between two parties, one party is in one place and other party in other place, or the party, the subject matter, the property is located in one place, whether the place of residence is to be taken, the place of property is to be taken, and there are various grounds are there, in which court, which place the case is to be filed, these aspects I will discuss in detail under this topic, that is the place of suing and place of suing. Then under this, order 1 to 4 of the, after order, under the order 1 to 4 deal with institution of the institutional frame of the suit. How to frame, how to file a suit, and how to frame the, how to frame the suits, and what are the points to be furnished in the suit. These aspects we will study in that particular section 22 to 25, order 1 to 4. Next, part 2. In part 2, section 36 to 74, order 21 to order 21. Section part 2 of the Civil Procedure Code, the body of the subject, body of the part 1, body, the body of the code containing 158 section, part 2 contains section 36 to 74 and order 1. So, this part 2 deals with the execution proceeding. Suppose the court awards a decree, the court gives order, the court gives injunction, the court gives maintenance, and when the court gives order in favor of the plaintiff, or the court gives order in favor of the petitioner, when the court gives order in favor of the applicant, and the court may give order, but implementation or execution of order is a very important thing. So that is why what happens is A files a case against B for recovery of 50 lakh rupees. But A files a case, he is hopeful that he will get degree. But the problem is how to recover that 50 lakh rupees from B with costs of the suit and interest. That is there. In such case that if the plaintiff is doubtful that even if the decree is passed, even if order is given, the B may not be able to give the money. He may abscond from the city, or he may abscond from the country, or he may dispose of the property. In such case, the plaintiff or petitioner may apply to the court, arrest him before the decree, arrest before judgment, or at all before judgment, or put the security of the some money for to meeting the crime, for such things he may request. So part 2 of the code containing section 36 to 74 and order 21 of the schedule lay down various provisions relating to execution of decree or order. And next part 3 contains section 75 to 78 and order section 75 to part 2 containing section 75 to 78 and order 26 lay down the provisions relating to issue of commissions, appointment of commissioners. This will take place in case of attachment arrest before judgment. Here issue of commission, when you go to court and observe that some lawyers say that, some junior advocates say that I am appointed as commissioner for some commission purpose, they are telling. So he is a commissioner for some commission. So sometimes in the basis for giving any judgment is evidence. So when a trial takes place, plaintiff side will be there, defendant side will be there, petitioner side witnesses will be there, respondent side witnesses will be there. So in course of time, some people will be able to attend the court and give evidence. Some information can be placed before the court. But some circumstances, what happens is, some persons will not be able to come to court. And some people, out of their status or something, they won't be able to come to court. Certain information is to be collected. For giving, for concluding the trial and for giving the judgment, some information is required. So there's a process to compel the further purpose, the appearance of some person, production of some document, production of some things, production of so many things are required. Sometimes they can be brought to the court, but sometimes they cannot be brought to the court. In such case, the court will appoint some advocate as a commissioner. The court will appoint a commission. For that commission, one advocate or somebody will be appointed. That man is called a commissioner. This man will go and investigate. He will make all necessary inquiry and collects necessary information and submit to the court. That is what is called commission. That person is called commissioner. That is called part 3 containing section 75 to 78 and order 26 of the Civil Procedure Code lay down various provisions relating to appointment of commissions and appointment of the commissioners. This process may take place in case of the people, the information required for trial is not available, and certain people who will not be able to come to the court, and the commissioners will go there and take up all investigation and bring the information. Next, part 4 and 5 containing section 79 to 93 and order number 27 to 38. Part 4 and 5 containing section 79 to 93 and orders 27 to 37 of Civil Procedure Code deal with suits in special suits or suits in particular cases. So, see, in a court of law, the suits will be filed by the people in general. But there are some cases, there are special kinds of suits are there. Special kinds of cases are there. These suits in general cases. Suppose suit filed by government servant or suit filed against a government servant. Though the procedure is something different. Because when a case is to be filed, when a suit is to be filed against a government servant, a notice of 2 months is to be served after. Suppose if any employee, for example, government servant or civil servant are conferred some special status, supreme status, and Article 311, Clause 2 of the Indian Constitution. Suppose a pune or class 4 employee in government, central government or state government pure, if any disciplinary action is to be taken, a notice of 2 months is to be served, an enquiry is to be constituted, and then only disciplinary action is to be taken. It must be given a proper time. But sometimes if it is the case of chief managing director can remove chief purchase officer or general manager without any notice. The vice chancellor of a notice can remove any professor without any notice. But their services are under pleasure, under doctrine of pleasure under Article 310 of the Indian Constitution. But the civil servants are given protection under Article 311, Clause 2 of the Indian Constitution. Similarly, with the CPC, coupled with CPC, if any action is to be taken, if any case is to be filed against a civil servant, that is public servant, a notice of 2 months is to be given. In extraordinary exigencies, the permission of the government, the concerned government is to be taken for taking any action. So here, the procedure in respect of civil servant, when a civil servant wants to file a case, and case is to be filed against civil servant, some special procedure is there. Section 79 to 82 of the Civil Procedure Code, the body, will deal with, lay down the provisions relating to suits by or against civil servant or government servant. Next, the second one is indigent person or pauper person. Indigent person or pauper. All these topics I will explain in detail. This is only simple summary, dear friends. Don't think that I am completing all this. I want to give you, some friends are very eager about this subject. I am receiving consistent reminders for this subject. They are approaching the examination. That is why in first lecture I am giving outline, and from next class onwards I will take up each and every topic and detail. I will give complete guidance. So indigent person. Who is indigent person? A man who is unable to pay court fee. That is a pauper. That pauper, poor man. Suppose there is a principle of natural justice that no one can be condemned unheard. No one can be condemned unheard. Even a terrorist